The Doctor Who Alhambra Podcast.
We don't polish turds.
Hello and welcome to the Doctor Who Alhambra Podcast, episode 129. Across the pond we have...
That's 229.
Brett, hello. 229. Either way, we got the 29 part. At least it's not, he didn't say 75.
Shit. I was thinking it was podcast 32.
And over the other side of the pond, we have...
Liam, hello.
Hello, I am Legeon. And I am...
Odd that you said 32, because I think that's where you originally popped into the podcast originally.
Really?
I think it's around that time period.
I was literally just plucking a number out of my ass there, so...
Yeah. Okay, well, in this podcast, we are going to be doing the definitive, yes, because it is the ultimate definitive breakdown discussion of Legend of the Sea Devils. However, we're going to also talk about Big Finish news and Liam's fantastical trip through the Facebook fan page, where he had actually legitimate discussions, which were deleted.
Do you know, I saw that, and... I went back to comment on it, and like you say, it was gone. And then I saw Liam's thing in the chat, and I was like, what?
Because apparently it wasn't in the comment thread of the original post. So I was breaking the rules.
But you weren't. Apparently that comment thread wasn't even there.
It was.
When you posted your thing. Was it?
Oh, it was. Apparently it was, but I didn't. Well, I don't know. It's Facebook. It's a crock of shit. So things just seem to appear and not appear. But apparently I was breaking the rules. So apparently I should have looked better. And
I encouraged Liam on a phone conversation yesterday because he was just like not happy about the whole thing, and he was just like, I think I'm going to leave the Facebook fan page, and I just said, no. You need to promise me you need to go out in a blaze of glory. I mean, you need to ultimately troll everything to the point where they remove you from the group. You don't remove yourself. That's what I want.
I'm going to die in a blaze of glory.
All right. So
sucks. Nerds.
Start criticizing.
There we go. That's the reaction I wanted.
Start criticizing Nick Briggs a lot, and
not just internally. You literally have to
Nick
just
Briggs is a
replace every swear with Nick
post.
Briggs.
All right. Well, before we get into, I think, the Facebook fan page, because this will lead us right into the Facebook fan page, we are going to go over the Big Finish news. And from the previous podcast, we now have a couple of more War Doctor things. We have the Doctor of War versus the Krolls, which is a up-and-coming box set.
No,
what?
No, it's not. No, it's not. That's the Unbound box set that's just come out this month. That's the Unbound Genesis one.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Yeah, guess what? I haven't listened to anything. So, so I guess moving on from that, we have Jerry Anderson's UFO destruct positive, which I will tell you, I am more inclined to listen to than anything that we might be talking about a little bit later, and. I have no idea what UFO destruct is, but they didn't really do a good job to promo it. It's just a video of
it's just music
space. Mm. Yeah, looking at Earth and then it turning to space, and then that's it. It was like, are you trying to get people interested or not? Because
it's another series that they've sort of rebooted. Same thing with Space 1999. You can start with the first, you know, release it. You don't need to have watched a TV series or whatever to understand what's going on, because it's a, you know, their version of it. But it's basically UFO on audio, which is another Anderson TV show
The only thing, I mean, I know this has been, we've all pre-ordered this, but the only thing that draws me to it is it's got Barnaby Kay in it. And I really, really like Barnaby Kay as an actor. And he's also
and it's
a
got,
good director.
Adrian Myers in it as well, which is also, oh no, not Adrian Myers, Harry Myers, sorry, which is good.
Oh God, yes, it does.
Excellent.
Returning to the Big Finish fold after years.
Finally. I think even more interesting and something that we have not gotten Humphrey's thoughts on at all whenever this popped up, we got cover art and story titles for Rose Tyler, Dimension Cannon, Other Worlds.
Oh, God. Really?
Yes. It's at least got Camille Kadoury in it this time. Who?
Uh-huh.
Yep.
And we have Mark Benton as Clive Finch. Yeah. Yeah, we got three stories. We have Saltwater by Allison Winter, Now is the New Dark by A.K. Benedict, and The Rogue Planet by Emily Cook.
Hmm. Oh!
Never heard of Allison Winter. I think she's a new writer, clearly.
She is.
Allison Cook is
A.K. Benedict.
Sorry, Emily Cook is the Doctor Who producer who did all the watch-alongs and tweet-alongs and stuff. And then I think she's one of the producers for Big Finish now, isn't she? So
yes. And A.K. Benedict is Guy Adams' partner.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I believe so, anyway.
So Allison Winter does have a future script that is going to be in the Unit Brave New World box set that's coming out in July. But yeah, that is her contribution. Also, just looking up Emily Cook, yeah, she was into the whole lockdown thing, which I will tell you, I think is the intent that was there. I think some of those lockdown watch-alongs help divide fandom more because they would always do... At first, they were trying to push the 13th Doctor episodes, and then everybody was just like, you know what? Hey, everybody, let's watch Bad Wolf. And then I feel as though that started overtaking Emily Cook's lockdown watch-along. And I think other watch-alongs were getting more hype than the actual one that was being like pushed out by the BBC and Emily Cook.
Yeah. Mm. However, there were some excellent bits from RTD during them. Because he popped up to quite a lot of them. And he was like, yeah, this happened. It was a barrel of laughs.
Yeah, RTD and Moffat actually like inspired a couple of watch-alongs at the same time too. So, yeah, it'll be interesting. Again, one of my biggest concerns about some of these box sets going forward, and I will tell you, I'm not apt to listen and pick up Rose Tyler, Dimension Cannon, not because. Again, I think that Volume 1 was a lot better than Lady Christina. And a lot better than New Earth. I mean, granted, those two are just horrible. I think Rose Tyler is a lot better. But my biggest concern, and I brought this up before, is the Winter Girl and Emily Cook. What have they done? Have they done a full cast audio before? I mean, granted, I would, like I said, mentioned before, I would really like it to be co-written by something. I mean, perhaps it was, you know, helped along by the script editor a lot. But where are they cutting their teeth in the world of Big Finish, especially full cast audios? Mm. I'm just not apt to invest money and also time in something where people have not done, you know, the Demons of Red Lodge. Give me a story in a 20-minute story in one of those things.
Yeah.
I forgot to ask. So really excited, Humphrey, for Rose Tyler, Dementia Cannon and Other Worlds?
No, I will not be listening to it.
We will if we gift it to you.
You will if we gift it to you.
Yes. You know, I'm
it's
so glad that.
Enjoy.
Oh, well, yeah, I'm going to have to like pull back on some of the things that for the April release, since that's a box set and I haven't listened to anything so far. So half the things that came out in April, I probably won't be listening to because I've been gifted that. So anyway, moving on, we have the second Doctor Beyond War Games. And so I bring this up because of a message that Legeon sent to me. We have the first two. Did we have the titles before?
Or no.
Okay.
We've only got now.
Yeah, we got two titles. We have The Final Beginning by Mark Wright and Nick Briggs. Mark Wright encourages hope for me. The other name, Wrath of the Ice Warriors by Andrew Smith. Just that title and that author right there. I mean, sign me up for that now.
And
yes,
it's only a 3-disc box set, but each story is 4 parts.
Ah.
In it.
Yeah. So I'm looking forward to that. I believe that comes out July of 2022. So that's something to
June, isn't it?
Look forward.
So it's June.
It says July right here on the news.
Oh, okay. Ah.
Also, and here comes our connection to, and Liam, feel free to interject anytime. So we have two announcements from the 23rd of April, 2022. Sasha Dhawan is the master of audio drama, and he will be in a series called Call Me Master. And also we have the Joe Martin brings a Fugitive Doctor to audio in, I guess, that. Well, maybe since you guys have read it, read what Liam posted on Facebook, maybe we'll get your guys' thoughts on both of these box sets. We'll start off with Humphrey, because I don't know what any of your thoughts would be about this.
I think it has potential to be interesting. I don't know if it's a series we really need. I would certainly be willing to give it a fair chance, because I actually quite liked Joe Martin in series 12. Was it series 12? Yeah, series 12.
Yes.
I thought she actually could make a very good Doctor. So I think it'll be interesting to see what Big Finish does with it. As I said, I don't know if it's a series we need, but as we're getting it, I'm certainly going to give it the benefit of a chance.
Legeon, what are your thoughts?
On which one?
Either
Martin
one.
Or
whichever
either
one
or.
You'd like.
So I'm excited by this, but, and there is a big but, Liam made a valid point of, we don't know the character. You know, what are Big Finish going to do? Are they going to make it their own? Are they going to, or are they going to be given guidelines by Chibnall, who by now, from what I understand, doesn't care?
Did you want to read out the post that I posted on Facebook? Well, because obviously it's not.
Let's let Legeon finish, and I will get to your post.
I'm excited, but worried. This is for the Joe Martin Fugitive Doctor. And are we going to get a specific placement for her? Or, you know, other things? Because people are losing their hair about this. They're like, yes, okay, she can have an audio series, but what's the placement of the Doctor? Is it going to be classed as main series? Is it going to be Unbound-esque? And then on the other side of things, I am glad we're getting a Sash Dhawan master series. I love Sash Dhawan. I think he's great. I feel his master was sort of dealt the wrong hand in writing. Similarly with Jodie.
Mm.
I feel we got Insanity, but I feel we will see a lot more from Call Me Master.
My thing about the Sasha Dhawan master is I feel as though he was, I agree with you, not written well. Also, I feel as though the John Sim master was written not well initially. And then when we had the Capaldi 10th series two-part finale or whatever, I finally feel as though that John Sims master, and then even though it didn't happen, the masterful box set or whatever, that John Sim master was written quite well. And I felt as though actually had a good voice compared to the RTD series and an improved voice from the Stephen Moffat end of 10th series thing. Mm. And so here's what Liam posted on the Facebook fan page, which was taken down as well as the like 12 comments at the time. And at the time that I saw it, I thought about to myself, let's take some screenshots, but I'm like, of course it will be there. And here's to me, and I brought this up to on a phone conversation to Liam yesterday. This is to me more telling of why it got taken down. Because if you look at the current thread that, you know, Liam supposedly broke the rules and posted this not on the thread, but on Liam's thread that he started, there were people that were actually legitimately like, I'm not sure I'm in for this right now. You know, they questioned it. Some of them were like, I think that the Big Finish could, you know, pull her the character out just a little bit for the Joe Martin doctor. But there's massive questionable. I think Liam's post got pulled down. Partially maybe because he broke the rules, but you had a string of people who weren't loving it. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the current post now, everyone's excited. Everyone's looking forward to it. Everyone is this. Mm-hmm. Everyone is this. There is no negativity. There's no questioning. And here's the post that we got from Liam that was since removed. It says, so what do people think of the announcement of the Fugitive Doctor and the Dhawan Master? Honestly, not sure how I feel about this. I mean, we don't even know the Fugitive Doctor's origin or really anything about her personally. So Big Finish may have a hard job writing her well. Just my opinion. What are others thinking? Again, you also prefaced it by just my opinion. Yes. And for that, your post was completely taken down, not comments turned off or like, you know, ended with, you know, admin saying, you know, we're ceasing discussion of this post because there's an actual other post or whatever. No, completely removed.
That's a bit ridiculous.
Yep. And that's why I'm like, I'm just tempted to leave, because it's like, well, clearly I can't even put a post up because it's not even in the correct thread. It's just, come on. I didn't see the thread in the first place.
No.
Yeah.
I didn't see the thread until it was pinned.
I think the admin's just overly officious.
I think you could possibly, you know, go back on the admin and be in, you know, you just say, hey, you know, I'm blind. I can't believe you did this. This is very offensive to me. Because, I mean, first off, you didn't see it there. And no, second off,
Facebook is a clusterfuck anyway half the time, and you miss posts.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not in any particular order.
No, that's what I mean. You know, that's why I didn't see the post. I saw the post about 2 hours after I posted my post.
Yeah.
So, but I just thought, I'm not going to get, I don't want to get in an argument because it's not going to end well if I do. So that's why I just didn't bother.
So I went to the Wild Wild West of Big Finish listeners page because I felt as though there would actually be legitimate discussion because, yeah, granted, it is wild, but they don't take you down for not posting in the right place. And so, you know, you have some people saying absolutely over the moon. They says, you know, that, this had to be done. Retcons are going to be, you know, pulling this out of the canon. Joe and Sasha were the only decent things that Chibs brought to Doctor Who. And a lot of people have some Alaffy emojis about that. A lot of people said that they like Joe's performance, but not her doctor. They did not like the companion. They also, you know, noted certain things about the Dhawan master just being like too insane and stuff like that, which I believe was what Liam was actually getting. He was actually getting a discourse and discussion before his thread was terminated completely.
Like, I tried to reply to somebody and I couldn't post a reply because it had been taken down, and it had been taken down as I was looking at the comments.
Well, yeah, well, because it was funny because this happened in real time. You sent, so I saw your Facebook thing because it just kind of popped up on my phone and I was like doing nothing at the time. Normally I'll like, you know, I'll look at that later, but I looked at it, thought for a second, maybe I should get some screenshots. Well, of course not. Why would I? I mean, look, this is a healthy string of discussion or whatever. The worst thing that's going to happen is they're going to turn it off. Liam then says to me probably about 5 minutes after I look at it, they turned off the comments to my thing. And then I look and then I reply immediately, no, they took it all down.
So
it's just not on.
No.
No.
You know, you should. Okay, positivity has its place in the world, but not everyone's going to be happy about this. It's like all the spin-offs. Not everyone is happy about the spin-offs of Big Finish. You know, I will be the first to admit, when The Lone Centurion was announced, I went, why? What's the point of this?
I mean, I wasn't critical. I was just like, I'm unsure at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is, do you know, it's a perfectly valid point to have.
It wasn't harsh at all. It was an opinion. It was even prefaced as an opinion. And yeah, I
was trying to start a conversation. And that's what you get for trying to start a conversation. You just get cut off.
To fully nuke that. You know, wait until the, when do I want you to do that? Wait until my summer vacation so that I can just like watch the entire thing come down. And then, you know, basically... then like 20 minutes later, just messaged me. It was like, hey, I've been kicked out of the group. I want to watch it in real time. So nuke your Facebook fan page account, but wait for my summer vacation.
Okay, fine. Well, give me questions to troll and I'll happily do it then.
All right. I will be working on trolling questions. And here's where I fall with the box sets. And I'm going to say this, and sadly, we've already discussed Humphrey's possible future box set of delight with the Rose Tyler Dimension Cannon. I'm going to say this, and I mean it. I will not listen to the... Fugitive Doctor or the Sasha Dhawan Master box set for 3 years. I don't care how great of a review it gets, how, you know, it could be 10 out of 10 immediate classic. I need some breath. I need some time away from the meddling madman that is Chris Chibnall and all of the things that he brought into the Doctor Who universe. I will not, it has nothing to do with Sasha Dhawan. It has nothing to do with Joe Martin. Has nothing to do about anything. I need time away from him and his so-called canon. I will not listen to this for 3 years. So keep that in mind. When you box set of delight me, it's going to be an instant. Okay, what's your other option? Because that's not happening. Yep. 2025 is when the soonest I will listen to either the Fugitive Doctor or the Call Me Master series.
Fair enough.
Do you know, I find it very, very interesting. I think the reason this got leaked was because a friend mentioned it to one of the producers the convention, because they were trying to find out what range that they were working on, and they went, oh well, is it the Joe Martin stuff? And she sort of smiled and said, oh no, but how did you hear about that? And then he replied with, well, I spoke to Joe Martin at a convention and she told me about it. So I think those box sets have been leaked maybe because of that, which I think is quite funny. But also, it's very telling, isn't it? That if you notice, Big Finish are very clear in their stuff and said, well, we can't do certain eras. We're only covered up to X Doctor and X Companions. We can only use this and this and this. And it's always been the fact of that the era has to be over and the next showrunner has to be kind of well entrenched before they can get their hands on whoever, whether that be Capaldi or Smith. And Chibnall's run's not even over. It's not even over. And they've announced Joe Martin and Sacha Dhawan. So what does that tell you?
It tells me that you're... where everybody's latest craze is going to be Pting Empire.
Oh, no. Taking on the space pirates.
No! The space pirates would destroy them and steal all their Argonite.
The Pting will just eat the Argonite.
I
talked to you about this yesterday, and my theory of why the BBC is allowing the Joe Martin Doctor and the Sacha Dhawan Master being used is because they no longer have creative control over the show. It is now in the hands of not a madman, Russell T. Davies.
They're like Welshman.
Exactly. They're like, you know, F you, we're going to, here you go, Big Finish. You get to play with this and tinker with this and maybe perhaps there'll be some problems going forward as they pet their cat.
While they're doing this, Big Finish is like, okay, let me just go over to the other line. So Russell, they've given us this. What do you want us to do with it? And Russell's just said, well, you know, I'd quite like you to do this. Oh, by the way, I'll write you another story if you like.
That would be so funny. I even told Liam that wouldn't you just love it that like this whole thing completely backfires on the Big Finish. The Joe Martin Doctor is actually beloved, and it was all because it was not something that was forced. It was not like, you know, it was an actually legitimate good story that their madman at the helm for the past 5 years. I mean three. I mean, I don't even know what I mean anymore, but like could not do like he basically Russell needs some like writing blue pills because he's come up limp a lot with his Doctor Who writing.
Hey, what, Russell or Chibnall?
Oh, sorry, Chibnall. Sorry, Russell. No, Russell's rock hard there. No. Sorry.
Rock hard Russell. Oh, dear.
His writing member is long, strong.
And prodigious. Yeah.
Oh. All right.
I don't know. It's a weird one. So we'll see. Oh, and I love the fact as well that it's just, there's no actual date set yet. It's just TBC.
Yeah, it's because they've not recorded them yet.
No. No.
Well, and the other thing is why I'm kind of also holding off on things is because they haven't recorded them, we don't have titles, and we also don't have the writers. Like I made mention with the Rose Tyler Dimension canon, that to A.K. Benedict, I'm familiar with says work, and I think he's, you know,
She.
Oh, A.K. Benedict, it's okay, she. Whatever. That they are a B tier writer. Like I would not classify as A, but definitely not bad. But then you have the other two unknowns. And if you know, the Joe Martin Fugitive Doctor series is going to be written by unknowns, props to Liam for, you know, just opening up his wallet and throwing the money down. I will not be doing that at all until at least 2025.
Did you see the further announcement in the Joe Martin segment? They've said that new well, or more new series stuff will be coming. So in that era.
Putting Empire.
No, it's going to be the Thasman Empire. What are you talking about?
No, no, it's not. It's going to be Ryan and Graham Investigate, yeah. Yeah, come on, Ryan, be chipper. There's a murderer on the loose.
Yeah, I am chipper. What are you talking about, man? I'm very excited. I just ejaculated, man.
I'm so excited, I'm actually moving my lips.
Here's a question. Who do you think would get more animated? Tosin Cole as Ryan or Sylvester Stallone?
I was waiting for you to say the Sea Devils because...
I wouldn't know. I've not watched it, so...
Oh, Liam.
Yeah, I scolded him yesterday, and he's just like, nope, nope, nope. I tried to shame him for it, but you know, he has no shame when it comes to that. He's very proud.
Yep, that's. Do you know what? It's fair.
I noped out after series 12, and I've not watched.
You did
series 13 or anything since, and I have no interest in watching series 13 or anything since. So.
Did you see my post that I tagged you in, Brett, in relation to the Second Doctor and Beyond War Games?
Yeah. So do you want me to pull that
what
up?
Was that?
Yeah.
I didn't.
Here we go. It's a nice surprise for you.
So Liam tagged me in this. So this is from...
Legeon tagged you in this.
Oh, sorry. Legeon tagged me into this. I was just pre-reading part of it. And my brain went on standby mode. So this is from everyone's favorite Big Finish listeners group. It starts off by asking the question, is Michael Troughton another curator? And so they said, you know, they discussed about the most latest Annihilators. They re-listened to it just the other day, and they said there's still a mystery over why the Second Doctor and clearly older Jamie are traveling together, which I think won't get resolved until 2023. They say, however, there's an odd bit at the end of the Annihilators where the Second Doctor explains to the Third that the recent events are all a long time ago for him, which doesn't at all sit with any season 6B ideals I might have had for the forthcoming box set, which Nick Briggs reminded me in the call Beyond War Games as I read it Beyond the War Games. It says, so given that we now know the curator is visiting more than just one of his old faces, and both the Tom and Colin versions clearly remember events of Stranded, placing them as further incarnations. So is Michael Troughton's character not actually the Second Doctor as we know him, but yet another curator?
Hmm. Interesting.
Some of the comments are really quite cool.
Yeah.
Somebody says, oh, did anybody pick up on in Stranded where they mentioned the leases were all sorted out by a man in a bow tie.
Oh. Huh.
That's interesting. I will say, when I have listened to the special features or the extended extras for the Annihilators, and Nick Briggs did make a comment about on purpose doing something a certain way in the storyline to get excitement for the Beyond War Games. So I am kind of curious about that. I'm curious if the part of what people are reading into for the Annihilators is being read into too much and maybe misinterpretation, or maybe it is, or maybe it was just poor writing for a moment.
We can't call the Annihilators poor writing.
Oh, no. But I mean, you know, you can have one or two lines that just don't work.
Yeah.
And they don't get seen.
True.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All right.
I think it's interesting. I look forward to this entire storyline.
Do you think Beyond War Games will tie into the Joe Martin box sets?
I don't know. I sure hope
if
not.
If the Fugitive Doctor is where people are thinking she's going to be placed, which is between second and third, potentially, because that's the only place really that she can be placed at this point. Yeah.
That would be, okay, you got some, wow. That is some big brain thinking right there, Liam. Wow. That's actually amazing. My hat's off to you, sir.
I could live with that, you know.
Mm.
So could I.
It would still not explain the regeneration limit thing, but I mean, you could just put that down to like a lie for the Time Lords and whatever, and Rassilon and all that. Because what it could be is, this Michael Troughton Doctor could be an older, you know, just older Second Doctor. And then before the exile thing, he regenerates into her. She does what she does. And then she finally gets caught up with and gets sent into exile. And it isn't Troughton that regenerates, it's her into Pertwee.
Sign me up for your newsletter, Liam. I'm very intrigued.
What I'm intrigued by is, so in the cast listing for Beyond War Games, in the first story is Tim Treloar.
Ooh.
I know. Now, I wonder whether it's Tim Treloar going to go into it as his natural, very Welsh self, or whether it's Tim Treloar playing a different character that is very Dandy-esque.
Well,
that he then, you know, imprints on.
It is, the name for Tim Treloar is Silas.
That sort of sounds like a dandy image, doesn't it?
Yeah. So yeah, that'll be interesting. I like that. You should put that in the Facebook fan page.
I don't know. I might be breaking some rules again.
You know what you should do just to like troll them? You know, start off every single one of your threads as, I'm not sure if this is covered somewhere because I'm blind, but, and then just do that. So if they remove that, you can like basically get after them for not either being helpful or not whatever. And I don't know. I don't know how, like, if you'd really want to constantly play that card, but you could do that just to get under their skin. Just be like, oh, well, we would remove this, but if we do, we're being hateful towards the blind community. So I guess we'll just have to leave it.
It's tempting.
Be.
It's very tempting.
Yeah.
Do it.
All right. So with that, let's get into our discussion breakdown of The Legend of the Sea Devils. And let's see, I'm curious, Humphrey, what did you think of The Legend of the Sea Devils?
Oh God, that's a god-awful story.
Wow. We haven't broken it down, Humphrey. Jeez.
I have to confess, I did keep falling asleep in it. So that kind of will give you a clue.
All right.
I've watched it twice, and I still don't know what the plot is.
This is a very interesting story.
I spoke to Craig about it because he's not got iPlayer, so I sent him the video file with the AD in it, and he said that he was glad that I did because the AD made it make more sense.
How has he not got iPlayer?
He's really cut back on, because he hasn't got a TV license for a TV, so.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right. So before we break this down, I mean, I can't believe that Humphrey already said that, because, I mean, that's just, what else are you going to say, Humphrey?
Oh, I loathe that story.
Humphrey, we haven't even broken it down yet. Jeez. Dance puppet dance. We have The Legend of the Sea Devils, and I want to talk about this because something stuck out to me just as I hit play to this on Thursday.
Bad CGI again?
Well, there is some bad CGI, but I mean, just as I hit play. So I picked it up on iTunes because I don't have BBC America anymore because I'm scaling back my package, but I did want to watch this. So we have, and so just as I hit play, I saw that this special was 47 minutes long. Yep. And for some reason, I thought, wait, isn't this supposed to be a special? That's yep. basically a standard. And so I started doing some investigation. And the Eve of the Daleks, you know, which according to the article that we read last week, was scaled back. And that special was 59 minutes. Okay. Previous specials from the RTD era, The Next Doctor was 1 hour. Planet of the Dead was 59 minutes. Waters of Mars was 62 minutes. End of Time Part 1 was 1 hour. End of Time Part 2 was 1 hour and 15 minutes. Yet this special was 47 minutes. And I will tell you, I think Chibnall had a hard time doing that.
Oh, yes. I mean, it's just, I don't understand the plot.
No.
All right. So let's get into this. Maybe we can make sense of it, or maybe we can end up just being confused together. So I do have some audio sounds that I ripped from this that we will listen to. I'm going to read. So I have two synopsises that I found. I can't believe that, you know. So the one synopsis came from my iTunes, which said, beneath the 19th century oceans lurk terrifying forces. How does lost treasure, pirate queen Madam Ching, the doctor, and the sea devils fit into a threat to threat the whole world? So, and then on IMDb, the synopsis is, the Doctor, Yaz, and Dan travel to the 19th century China, where a small coastal village is under threat from both fearsome pirate queen Madam Ching and a monstrous force which she unwittingly unleashes. So, I mean, to me, reading one of those synopsises was just like, okay, I think I get it. But two of those actually kind of make part of the story make just a tad bit more sense.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, isn't that a bit like rubbish, the fact that there's two synopsises for it? They can't even decide on one synopsis. They have to have two.
Well, the whole thing, you know, about Madam Ching, mm-hmm. basically awakening an evil, that happens within the first 5 minutes.
Yeah. So the opening scene, because I almost started trying to see how many like scene changes we do, because well, let's just say Flux and all the 90,000 scene changes per episode. So opening scene, rainy village, 1807, eyes on looking from the confines of a house. The pirate queen is heading towards a statue, possibly unleashing something dreadful. So the with a sword in hand and an encouraging So with a sword in hand and encouraging, if anything happens to me, the duty passes to you. So says a father to his son. And, you know, just by saying this, you know he's already dead. The statue yep. is that of a swashbuckling-looking sea devil holding a miniaturized man in his hand. Mm. The pirate queen chips the statue repeatedly, and in doing so, awakens an essence trapped within. And though the treasure looks to be just a stone with some writing on it, the statue explodes, releasing the sea devil, and the dude, the father, surprisingly is dead. Cue opening.
Question. Why would you want to chip away uh-huh. a statue anyway? Like, how did she know to chip away? Yeah, but how did she know to chip away the statue? I don't understand how she knew.
Because she's a pirate.
There's a lot of things where okay. you have, like, Chibnall releases lots of information way, way, way late. And I feel as though you have to be looking and taking notes like I did while I was watching this episode, because if not, I could definitely see you missing things.
Twice.
So, round. Yeah. So with that, I'm going to play our first clip.
Dan, hurry up. Four centuries off. Why's that?
We finally got to a beach.
Yeah, when we weren't aiming for one. Centuries off what I wanted. What are you wearing?
What she gave me.
Too much.
Way too much.
You said I looked all right.
Yes. Did you dress down up like this?
She said nautical would suit me.
I can't leave you alone for a second.
At least you didn't bring the hook.
Ow! Ow! Ah! Ah! Hi, Jack, you all right? What's that about? Unless...
Your skin's a bit off.
Kinetic hypercurve. Very odd. You try. See? Geomagnetic disturbance. Maybe a localized core. Might be where the TARDIS was pulled off course. Question is, why? Come on.
So what we get with that is the doctor landing. That was just right after the whole introductory scene. We have them just goofing around. They've found the wardrobe compartment. And then the doctor's ear starts getting pulled towards the ocean. And then they start skipping stones. And the stones, for some reason, after a couple of skips, just like jettison far right. And like as if something is, they either hit something or something is pulling them that way, which to me meant something more sinister or more evil lurking beyond the waters or some form of thing. I still feel as though, even though I've watched this and took notes, the thing that was causing it, you'd think would be some sort of like force field, but it still doesn't make any sense why the stones were doing that, at least to me, or why her earring was pulling her head towards the ocean. I don't know. Is it just me or?
No, it's not just you at all. It's why does anything happen in this story? There's a bit later on in the story we're going to get to that really enrages me because it didn't need to happen. But I just, this story is just a whole cluster of what, why did that happen? Why did the doctor even allow that to happen? That's not the doctor's character. What are you doing? Where is the plot? I'm sorry, I'm missing a plot. We're just getting, ooh, exposition, action, action, action. Ooh, death.
Yeah.
Hey, look, it's Tegan.
Oh, well, I mean, supposedly that was, yeah. And that's not even in, supposedly in this episode. That's my theory for why they did that is because I think they had heard rumors of the latest Spider-Man movie with all of the special cameos or whatever. And I think Chibnall was like, let's get into that because that might get people to watch. I mean, granted, I chased them all away, but maybe I'll bring them back because of cameos.
Oh, you know what's going to happen. I know we're jumping ahead a bit now, but you know what's going to happen in the centenary special, which apparently is feature length. So for Chibnall, that's going to be 52 minutes. you know what's going to happen is there's going to be a massive scene. Now, I don't want to say he's stealing from anywhere, but I'm going to suggest it's either going to be on some form of military base or airport. And there's going to be two teams. One team is going to be the Doctor and the Doctor's buddies. And then on the other side is going to be like Cybermen and Daleks and the Master. And then next minute, we're going to get a dude who just magically appears and, you know, like swooshes over and like takes off his red and blue mask with big googly eyes and goes, "Hi, hi, I'm Spider-Man, big fan of the Doctor. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you."
And that's how they make Tom Holland the next Doctor. Gotcha.
Well, you know, it's Sony. They can use Spider-Man in Doctor Who now.
Nah.
Yeah.
So one thing that sticks out to me even more about that scene, the Doctor, upon landing, pulls out her sonic screwdriver to determine where they are. They just left the interior of the TARDIS.
The sonic screwdriver doesn't have a screen. It is a sodding screwdriver. Its main purpose is nails.
Yeah.
And screws.
So my main question about that is the Doctor and the is the TARDIS jealous and is like giving the Doctor a silent treatment because it does not like this Thasman thing that's going on? I mean, like, why did they not look at the screen? Are we so invested in the sonic screwdriver doing everything for us that something that doesn't have a screen can tell you where you are, but the machine that travels in space and time that has screens everywhere can't do that?
Do you know what they need to do to the sonic screwdriver?
Destroy it.
Visitation it.
Yeah.
Yeah. JNT it. And do you know what? I would love it if the Pterodactyls did it again. They'd be like, we've done this before, Doctor.
Drop the sonic device.
Isn't my day, is it? I feel as though you've just killed an old friend.
That would be great. That would be super great.
I like the Pterodactyls.
Do you know, my theory on that is actually, the TARDIS secretly doesn't like the Doctor because even the TARDIS knows that the Doctor's off and there's something wrong with the Doctor. And so all the places that she's taking the Doctor to, she's trying to get the Doctor purposely killed.
Yeah. Interesting. It's like, come on, let's just get this regeneration over with. Don't worry, you'll thank me for this.
Yeah. Yeah.
It'll
hurt, but you'll be fine.
So here's where, again, we have some really bad CGI and I think overall direction for how the scene played out. So when we get to the Sea Devil basically wreaking havoc in this town, they basically kind of did a Power Rangers type of a situation and then people falling and yelling and dying. Because if, you know, from the original Power Rangers series, you would have some sort of thing making swooshing and swiping motions with a sword, with their hands, with their tentacles, and then explosions would happen, and then people would just, like, the Power Rangers, whatever, would fly away in slow motion. If it was somebody, they could be hurt, knocked out, or whatever. But what they did is they had the Sea Devil with some sort of lightsaber-ish type of sword swishing and swiping vigorously with different angles, with clouds in the background, with rain also in the background, people falling down dead. But it didn't seem to correlate. Like, it might swipe up and somebody would, like, swipe, it would fall down to the left. It's just like, how did that work? And I will tell you, it was at...
I like Power Rangers.
I will tell you, I'm super excited for my YouTube channel. I am going to be reviewing Power Rangers versus Godzilla.
Oh. Yes!
Oh, no way. Mate. Are you serious?
Yeah. I'll be watching that one.
I mean, it's only issue one because it just barely came out like about a week ago. But I'm...
Which Power Rangers? Which?
I'm going to say the original ones with Jason as the Green Ranger.
Red Ranger.
No, not Jason. Whoever. Tommy. Tommy is the Green Ranger, yeah.
No way. Oh, that sounds awesome.
Anyway, that's besides the point. It was at this point in the episode where my iTunes, my Apple TV, just stopped wanting to play. I could not.
Don't make me do it.
I could not get it to play this episode. I reset it. I push play. It would not play. And to me, that was this like, I think it was trying to tell me you'd be happier, you know, doing the Liam option and just watching Rich's YouTube channel to find out what you think about it rather than actually finding out for yourself. So, and then we get this fantastic bit of dialogue right here.
Would you prefer to be addressed?
Where is it?
Mr. Where is it? Lord, where is it? Why are you trashing this place?
Who are you?
I'm the Doctor. No! And I just caught a whopper. What is that?
You think such feeble material can hold me, can hold any of my kind?
We have this weird situation where the sea devil is again wreaking havoc in town. The doctor, after they had that gripping dialogue revolving around this and that and scanning this, they run to the town to find so many people dead or whatever. And miraculously, there's a net laid out to a pulley system. And when the sea devil, like it was like the Scooby-Doo where they already had a trap planned and placed before they even knew that there was a villain that they had to capture. That was like the most like what was going on.
It was Scooby-Doo-esque, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You can almost imagine the doctor going, well, there's this conveniently laid out, you know, plot. Plan a trap, blah blah blah. This is what we're gonna do. So, Scoob, you're gonna run through there, and all this time, Yaz is just giving doe eyes at her, and Dan's just saying, like, jinkies.
I don't know.
What I will say though, did anybody notice the voice of the Ice Warrior?
Sea Devil.
That's the one, Sea Devil.
Wrong monster, Leech.
No.
No. Thank for once. Who is it?
It's the same guy who was Carbonista,
isn't it?
Oh, really?
Oh.
Yeah.
No, I did not notice that. I will tell you.
Do you know what I wanted to see there in the episode? I wanted them to do the Sea Devil scream. Why wasn't that a thing?
Yeah. I know what you mean. Do you know what as well? They had the perfect monster they could have used in this. The his name's gone out of my head. The Merker?
Yeah, that's what I was hoping for.
They're like, oh yeah, let's get this randomly Chinese named dragon. It's a fucking Merker, for God's sake.
Yeah, and then, you know, I feel as though that this was a mix of Chris Chibnall wanting to do a Star Wars story with a couple of Pirates of the Caribbean stuff, because, I mean, we get the whole floaty pirate ship, which at one point in time I felt as though it was very similar to Jabba's barge on Return of the Jedi. And then, of course, they all have lightsaber swords, which is just like, isn't it just a sword with poison on it? Why does it have to light up? Like, and then whenever it hit something, there was like electronic charge coming out of it. It's just like, what's going on? Like, did you really think this through? And also, Did nobody tell you that this was not a good idea? I'm probably, even if they did, he probably was like, you're fired.
I'm waiting until we get to the ageless dude from the 15th century. I don't get that.
Okay. So, yeah.
I mean, the one thing that kind of baffles me as well is, have we got to the bit where she... where Madam Ching pilots the
nope,
ship.
Nope, not yet. We have not. The Sea Devils just barely got a call from their Sea Devil overlord, and they came in with the floaty ship, and he congratulated them for their loyalty to him. And it's just like, well, wait. So they've just been underground waiting for a distress call. Anyway, I'm getting way too far ahead. So anyway, we have the doctor prevents the slain man's son from being killed by Madam Ching because he wanted to kill her because he blamed her for his father's death because he would still be alive had she not selfishly tried to, crack open the statue that they told her not to. But she,
and how does he know that?
Because
how does he know that?
He watched it happen.
Oh, right.
So then we get the backstory behind Madam Ching and for the reasoning behind breaking the statue, which is her all of the people that she was in command over, they were taken hostage by some other pirate. So then she needs to get this treasure so that she'll get her people back because she misses them because she is a good captain.
She's that good, she commits incest.
Yep.
Anyway, so then we
Jim
get
didn't
this...
mention that one.
No.
Duty's mine now. I'm not going to let her get away. We can get on her ship. Make sure my father didn't die in vain.
How are we going to get on there?
Swim, of course.
You're supposed to wander off.
Rule one, don't wander off. Why didn't you stop him?
Why is it my fault? He's a grown man. Since when do sea devils have a ship?
So you know them? These sea devils?
Crossed paths once or twice.
Where do they come from?
Ah, slight wrinkle there. Earth. They were here before humans. They regard Earth as their own planet.
That's not good.
Just try to get a trace on this sea devil ship. I'm not getting anything. They've masked their route.
They must know I'm onto them. Maybe it's time to have a word with Madam Ching.
She didn't take much notice of you last time.
Nope, but she did give something away. She's looking for the lost ship of Jihun and the lost treasure of the Flor Delamar. Now, what if we had it?
But we don't have it.
But what if we did? That'd shut her up and bring her on our side. I mean, that's what we came for in the first place, to find out what happened, and then we got diverted, of course. Well, I'm diverting us back on.
What? We're leaving without Dan?
He wandered off. Now we're wandering off too. Short hop, a few centuries. If I can access the TARDIS databanks to find the last known sighting of a ship with a commander named Jihun.
This is where a time machine comes in handy.
Exactly. We find out what happened to Jihun. Maybe pick up the lost treasure, zoom back to bargain with Madam Ching, and track down those sea devils.
All right, so...
I like the music.
Oh, yeah. The music is very good. Out of all the Doctor's companions who have always wandered off, and, you know, Joe is, like, the number one, like, you know, person to have done that, why is the Doctor so moody that Dan wandered off? It's almost like she was just like, I can't believe.
She's like, why did he do it? He's a man. He's useless. He can't be left on his own.
Oh, yeah, that. Oh, and did you notice Yaz's comment about the Sea Devils? Oh, you know, she's like, oh, yeah, doctors are, they see it as their own. They were here before humans.
Oh, that's not good.
Like, well, sorry, they were here before us. So, yeah, they've got every right to go, hang on a minute.
The best thing so far about this episode has been the music.
Yeah. Like, I'd be interested to actually listen to the actual soundtrack of that.
Yes.
When that comes out.
If it ever comes out.
If it ever comes out. But
they don't sell, do they?
Don't they?
No. They've not sold a soundtrack since Series 12.
Wow. But
nothing sells with Jodie's era, though.
Yeah. So, Dan and the son of the guy who was killed stow away on Madam Ching's ship. only to be quickly found and tied up upside down because one person can, you know, basically do that to two people. And yeah, so they
know why that is. Because she's a woman, sister, right? Doing it for herself.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So they noted
still no mention
that
of incest.
They noted that she has no crew and it's a big ship. And then because we're on a ship, we see it is a Chibnall story. So, of course, we are setting a course for the USS Setting Change. And the Doctor and Yaz land in 1533 and to discover what was going on with Jing Hun and his ship. So we get...
So basically what you're saying is... they're on that ship, and she's the only person piloting it, right?
Yep.
Yes.
At this point. That's accurately impossible.
I mean, she did have a system of pulleys set up, so she did that.
I don't care. It's not possible. A skeleton crew for a ship of that size would be 50 people, and that's skeleton. That's why she needs all these people. It's not because she's a good captain. She needs them to pilot the bloody ship.
Historically, just jumping in again here, she wasn't a good person.
No, not historically, no. Because she's a pirate, for God's sake.
She's a pirate, you know, who
pirates are good people, aren't
killed
they?
Her husband, then married her adopted son, incest, but it's not illegal because he was adopted, then killed him. Then what? Killed hundreds and hundreds of people. She was not a good person. You should not be making a hero out of this person. That's basically like going, oh yeah, you know, Hitler, he had his flaws, but let's use him as a, you know, let's use him to fight some aliens in this World War II story.
Yeah. I'm sure he was an inspirational figure somewhere.
Oh. All right. Here's this cut, because I don't know a good segue for that.
Loving the honesty. Isn't it a
mutiny? He's throwing them off.
Jump to your feet! Now! I said leave!
He's forcing them off to dag in the water. What is that? It's not natural mist.
My lord, my ship is yours.
Jihun's in league with the sea devils. Why would he do that?
Do you have what we agreed?
I do.
How does it feel to betray your own?
What's that?
You expect me to honor an agreement with a land crawler like you? Sorry!
His ship is going down. Back to the TARDIS. What's he doing? I mean, that's the trouble with history. Never anything like the books. Same as Stephen King movies. And we didn't get the treasure. No. But we did get something Madam Ching doesn't have. An exact location of where the ship went down. And a TARDIS that can take us to the same spot in the future. Yep, 274 years, 4 months and 2 days. Into the future will take us back to where we left Dan. Even if he did wander off, and onto the ocean floor, where, with a bit of luck, we'll find the wreck of Jihun's ship and the lost treasure. Do you see how quick that was? And we'll bang on. Come on. Tell me you're impressed.
You're like a kid sometimes.
Thanks. What, only sometimes? Let's take a look at this shipwreck.
Wait, are we underwater? Shipwreck, bottom of the ocean.
I know, I love being at the bottom of the ocean.
And you're gonna open those doors?
Oh yeah. Oxygen bubble. And I reinforced it with an aqua shield as well, just in case. Be a bit embarrassing if we drowned after all this.
spectacular. What a universe. What a planet. Just when you think you've seen the lot, it's something like this. It's stunning. Yes, it is. Not a bad day, am I? No. Something's missing. No ship, Sherlock. Not even the tiniest sign. Where's the ship? It's only been 274 years. At the very least, there'd be a wreck.
Definitely in the right spot.
These are the exact coordinates where it went down. It can't just have disappeared into thin water.
Could it have moved with the currents over time?
Maybe. But there'd still be mineral detritus, and I'm not getting anything.
It's a clear sign of Thasman being pushed on us. Yes. Oh, not a bad day, Emma. Nobody cares. The Doctor should be asexual.
Notice the pause there, though. I'm not a bad day, am I? Long pause. No.
Yeah. It's like...
You had to think about that, didn't you, then, for a second?
You know, when Yaz is stood there, it's stunning. What is she looking at? Is she looking at the ocean or is she looking at the Doctor?
They're looking out at the ocean floor because they're on the very bottom, which, you know, let's just say it was very well lit for being on the bottom of the ocean and, you know,
well, light, you know what they say about under the sea.
Under the sea, under the sea, there'll be no accusations, just friendly crustaceans under the sea.
So, I mean, to me, with that clip, the first issue I have is the main sea devil has a beaming technology that he comes out of a fog, and you'd think, okay, so this is a technology and it is shared by all sea devils. Nope. As we go through the entire story, he's the only one that can teleport and come in and out of this fog-like teleporty beamy thing.
Yeah.
All of their swords. Yeah. All of their swords, beam me up fish sticks. All of their swords do lightsaber crashes, which just, again, why?
Well, they got to spend the budget on something, because it's certainly not plot.
Oh, it's not plot. And you know what I was not thrilled at all to this point with any of anybody's acting at all. I feel as though it was just like
wooden.
Yeah, I felt as though it was just like everybody. Hey, you know what? Mail it in. That's fine. Like, who cares?
Yeah. See, secretly, they said they filmed it in like the studio, Rothlock Studio, and it's all done through Zoom.
Oh. All right. So as we pick up, the TARDIS gets eaten, and as well as the Doctor and Yaz, by the sea devils, Merker creature, but something else. And they are taken into the Earth. Meanwhile, the first moment of joy for this episode happened, at least for me, at this part right here. This is about minute 20 of the episode, and this is where I actually enjoyed at least part of this episode.
Polaris.
I always thought that I'd learn the constellations, but then I just downloaded an app on my phone. But I haven't got my phone with me.
I don't understand half the words you say.
You're not the first to say that.
My guess there, which would mean...
Did you see? The stars just moved.
The world has been disrupted.
Because of you. Because of what you unleashed.
We have to get to this place. Nothing is more important than getting our hands on that treasure.
Why is it so important to you?
Is that yours? What?
She's got both.
You want to know why I'm on this ship alone? My crew were taken. They're being held hostage by Gopaldi and the Black Flag Fleet. There's a ransom to pay, or they all die.
So, to me, my favorite part of this entire episode was when they're talking about the constellations and Dan just said, I wanted to always memorize a constellation, but I've downloaded an app instead. That was my first moment of joy.
Dan is just an excellent companion. If we can take one thing into the new RTD era, please let it be Dan.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean,
unfortunately,
you know,
I don't
what?
Think it's going to be there, is it?
Here's the sad thing. And I made mention to this to Liam yesterday on the phone. So we have Graham, who is written well. It is a likable, enjoyable character. Dan, you could almost say, is like Diet Graham to some extent. So it's almost the same character, except just different and different backstory.
Scouse.
I don't think Chibnall does a good job of writing minority characters.
No.
No, he doesn't.
And I brought this up, and I'd like you to think about this. So we have, so he altered the history for Madam Ching. I, you know, don't know why he did that. But think about his character, you know, I'm trying to figure out if it's actually Tosin Cole's acting, or it was Chibnall's writing that made that character poor. Think about, you know, Curtis from The Misfits when he was on the Revolution of the Daleks or whatever. His character was written very poor. Like, I don't know. I don't think he writes... He's trying to put a lot of characters in, but he's not doing a good job of writing most of them. And for some reason, to me, and I'm trying to be, look at things
diplomatically,
but the only two characters that I feel as though he's written well are the two old white guys.
Yep. Because he is an old white guy.
I don't know. I hate saying that, but I'm trying to think of other characters that he has written well. I mean, is there any other characters that I'm missing that he's written well?
So in Doctor Who, no. But I've only just realized how whitewashed it is. And I hate to use that term, but Broadchurch. There are very few minority characters in that.
Yeah.
And there are there are a fair few late 30s to early 50s and older men that are written very well. Huh. That's a thought I didn't expect to have on a Sunday night. Wow. He's just not a very good writer, is he?
No. No, he's not.
I mean, and if anybody out there listening to the podcast, what are your thoughts? I'd love to hear. Like, do you think he has written other characters, minorities, well? Because I, for the life of me, can't think of it. So the Doctor and Yaz are prisoners of the Sea Devils, and we have a lot of pointless banter at this point. We have Jing-Hun's ship. It is the missing ship that it was at the bottom of the ocean to reveal to be the floating Sea Devil ship, and the leader still looking for the keystone. And we find that Jing-Hun is still alive, has been put in carbonite. Oh, sorry, my bad. Other storyline. In a carbonite-like force field that prevents him from aging but can also talk. And... yeah. So Jing-hun tells the doctor that his plan was to give the keystone to his most loyal crew member. Sadly, the crew member gave it to Percy Shelley. And so because he's an important person from history and he wrote some poetry, the whole wide world will have to be wiped out because the doctor does not want to get rid of one poet. But, you know, millions of people can die in the future and it's fine. It's fine.
No full discrimination necessary.
God.
I mean,
Chibnall, I am your editor.
He's just like, actually, Chibnall would go up to him, shake his hand, and goes, "And what is your job again? I'm sorry, I've never seen you before.
You are a traitor and a member of the Rebel Alliance."
Yeah, and then Palpatine pushes in something plot.
I mean, God. No, we find out that the keystone was given to his most loyal crew member, and
it's called a keystone, is it? Okay.
Yeah. All right. So, and then so the dead
stone, and it's a key.
Yeah. So we find that the dead. So we find out that the dead guy's son is the great, great, great whatever of the descendant of Jing-hun's most loyal crew member and was more special. And so his father said to him just before. Yay. And so as we rethink about all the things that was said just before, he said, I can't believe I've been watching this statue for my life. And today is the day that I retire. Nothing could possibly go wrong. And I will hand this over to you. And then, of course, he died.
Damn.
But,
that was 2 days for retirement.
And suddenly the animator had a sudden heart attack.
Are you kidding? The animator died like before the story began. And Trish Chibnall turned to his like 17-year-old who's like doing A-levels. He's like, how good are you at animating things?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I'm doing...
Oh, wait. That's why he didn't
engineering.
Actually, I'm going into dentistry, but I did take a class when I was 11 once.
Yeah.
At summer camp.
Anyway, we get this cut right here.
The Earth's geomagnetic poles, south to north, north to south, longitude to latitude. That's why even the stars feel like they're moving. You want to create chaos, melt the ice, shift the current, change the pressure until the whole Earth is flooded.
We're reclaiming what was ours. It is our right, and it is our time. It's done, Doctor.
What do you mean it's done?
The plutonic crystal has been sent down. The sequence will begin. Our Earth will be gloriously aqua once more. And my kin are ascending to reclaim this ship.
Say hello to my crew. Go.
So we
the
get
the plutonic crystal. Where did that come from?
So that was the thing that the guy who died, whose great 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 grandfather was Jing-hun's most loyal crew member, had a necklace that we never got seen passed down to him, but he was wearing it the entire time because, he had this plutonic crystal around him, which is going to give the Sea Devils the power to melt the ice caps, turn the Earth or whatever. I was actually waiting for Jody's doctor to just be like, you know what, just wait a couple hundred years. Human beings will do it to themselves. Why don't you take over then? I was totally waiting for something like that. So
hang on. So there's a keystone thing which opens something, and now the crystal that we don't see that's now there. What?
So the keystone was supposed to lead to the crystal, but the crystal was literally...
But it didn't, though, because the crystal was being worn by somebody.
Exactly, so and was literally right? inches away from Madden Ching the entire time.
Am I right in thinking as well? Right. Doesn't Dan go complete murder hobo on some sea devils?
Oh, we're getting to that part. I am so glad that you brought that up. So that scene right there cuts to human versus sea devil lightsaber fight on Jabba's deck. And so Chibnall, right, and this is so bad. So one of the sea devils, I'm not sure if it's the main leader or one of the sea devils, takes the sword and in slow motion goes to, you know, cut, you know, Jody's like face off. And so Jody does the worst Matrix slow motion duck, it missing her face probably by like a fraction of an inch. So think about the special effects for the Matrix, except done horribly worse and doesn't even look authentic at all. And that's what that scene would look like right there. So then Jing Hoon, who basically is annoyed that he has been in prison for over like 300 years, kept conscious the entire time, angry that the Lord Sea Devil did this. He has the sword and he runs it right through the Lord Sea Devil and kills him. And then the doctor decides to start scolding him for killing the person who was in prison and tortured him and killed all of his men right there. But just one second. But we also overlook part 6 of the Flux, where she schemed and plotted to destroy as many Cybermen as possible, as many Daleks as possible, and as many Centaurans as possible, murdering them all. But she's mad that he killed the Sea Devil that tortured him.
Oh, it gets worse.
Yeah, it gets worse. Let's see. But... It gets worse a little bit later. So now I'm going to play this.
It's starting.
I thought you said you couldn't remember how she worked it.
Yeah, well, I was wrong. Maybe it was that one. Did you say anything to the doctor? About what I said to you?
Like what?
I don't know. Something.
Has she said something to you?
Why? What would she say to me?
Oh, come on, Yas. Can't you see it?
Geomagnetic instability is increasing. Out of the way. There's no time. Hold tight.
So, the whole
Hang
world
on.
Is.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
So, that scene was. Have you said anything to the doctor?
Mm-hmm.
About what? I don't know.
About just, what was
how do you not
talked
know the answer?
About between Yaz and Dan during
yeah.
Eve of the
yeah,
Daleks.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. And then she says, "Oh, I don't know." How can you not know if you've asked a doctor yet or not asked her? Like, was it me or was that scene really bad? Just
well,
the
not only that,
just...
but you know, the whole world is about ready to be flooded over, and you know, we're very concerned that Dan is spreading rumors.
Yeah.
Yes.
And was it me, or was, you know, when she was like talking to Dan and she was like, "Oh, I was wrong." Was it me, or was she really snappy in that scene?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Like RB, you know, RBF, like resting bitch face or what? It was just.
So, and then we get to the best scene in the entire world, which is so funny. Actually, this goes into what Legeon has been wanting to say for like the past 5-ish minutes or so. So after Dan saw Jing Hoon take out the one sea devil that tortured killed his crew, tortured him for over 300 years or whatever, and getting scolded for that, you know, not to mention, you know, the doctor, you know, basically annihilating so many Centaurans, Cybermen, whatever. You know, let's overlook all that. So they break up. Yaz and the doctor go to the TARDIS or go to undo what that sea devil captain dude did and stop the world from flooding. Dan and the pirate queen decide to take on basically a small army, at least a group of six sea devils that I counted, and using the skills that Dan watched probably in Empire Strikes Back, took out six sea devils in like two swipes.
Yes.
How? He's got no experience with swords.
Quite.
Because Dan is secretly a supervillain who has no problem murdering as many aliens as it takes for him to get to his goal and him be revealed as...
Yeah, Dan is the master. Yeah, Dan is the master. I tell you, it makes sense now.
Yeah. Sash Dhawan just turns up like in the next episode. This is the day you die. And Dan's just like, oh, calm down, me. This is just some random psychopath I found. You can call me the master.
Actually, he says Dan Master instead of the master. Yeah.
And you will obey me.
Oh. So yeah, we so
look into my eyes.
Oh dear God.
So the doctor goes with Yaz to stop things from blowing up, and we get this scene. You know, again, world about ready to be destroyed. A whole bunch of other things happening. Might blow up, but...
Just going into this scene.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone, what does the doctor normally do if there is trouble? What is one of her main goals in relation to people?
I will blow myself up. You guys live. You guys survive. Your lives are important. You matter.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Note that for this scene.
Simple but delicate. I need to short circuit the power and internalize the charge. If I localize the power, this base becomes the densest place on Earth. No one, no sea devil, no human will be able to leave for a very long time.
We'll be able to get out first though, right?
Yeah. Hopefully.
Hopefully.
Definitely. One of those. I just need to get this done. You know what I said earlier about not being a bad day? Well, it's not something I really do, you know? I mean, I used to, have done, and if I was going to, believe me, it'd be with you. I think you're one of the greatest people I've ever known. Including my wife.
You what?
Oh, I wasn't going to mention that. It was a long time ago. I was a different man back then. But the point is, if it was going to be anyone, it'd be you. But I can't.
Why not?
Because at some point, time always runs out. Oops, I just lessened the time. 50 seconds.
What?
I need to get back to the TARDIS. This cable needs to hold. Yes, you have to go. Get the others out. I'll keep this in place.
No, you go. I'll hold it.
I can't ask you to do that.
The world out there isn't mine. But if I can help preserve it for others, all those centuries will not have been for nothing.
You truly are a legend.
And you need to run.
So...
That wait a minute. Wait a minute. Brett, you didn't tell me you were in that episode. You didn't tell me you were doing Fashion of Legion, doing Hugh Grant.
don't put me on the spot like that. That's when I choke. I could. No, Liam, I am not. Oh my gosh. Yeah. You know, here's the problem. Jing Hun should have written poetry. Then the doctor would have allowed him to live.
Yeah. Oh, it's just like, no, the doctor would not do that. And it's not the first time in the 13th Doctor's era that she's done this. Oh, no, I can't possibly ask you to sacrifice yourself. It's fine. You know, I'm terrified. I'm shitting myself. But you go, Doctor. It's fine. Okay, bye.
And
mm-hmm.
I put this down.
You know,
this
timeless children. timeless children again. Mm. Right there, that scene there. And clearly it didn't work because, oh, wait, they're all back for the centenary.
Yeah, I put this down. I said, this is now the Chibnall's lazy doctor trope at this point, where it's just like, and it's kind of a lazy point, to be honest, you know, where the doctor's just like, no, let me do this. I'll sacrifice myself. And then, you know, either it's like clunk, knock them out. And then somebody was like, you drag them off to the TARDIS. I will do this for you. But again, with this, it's just like, and we even go back to the timeless children at the very end, where the doctor's about ready to sacrifice herself, and then that one guy who's just like, no, let me do this. And then they're like, and she, like you said, okay.
Mm. Yes.
And she sort of like goes so fast that she leaves an after image.
Oh.
Zoinks!
Yeah.
See you later. Meep, meep.
Oh. So the episode
Fringe.
Dan and Di might be making a comeback, even though Di is mad at him, at least the last time we met, because he didn't show up, even though she was abducted before they were meant to meet. She still could not see him anymore because he was not there, even though he also kind of somewhat got abducted. But so their relationship might be on the mend. And then we have...
They've not spoken
Hang
since.
On.
This.
You okay? Yes. I can't fix myself to anything. Anywhere. Or anyone. I've never been able to. That's what my life is. No, of course. Not because I don't want to. Because I might. But if I do fix myself to somebody, I know sooner or later, it'll hurt. My nanny says, courage is knowing something will hurt and doing it anyway. Mind you, she also said it's the definition of stupidity. We just live in the present of what we have while we still have it. Sure. Make a wish and skim it.
All right, I'm going to stop her right there. And then they skip a stone.
Can we live in the present? Yeah. Can we live in the present so I can string you along for a bit longer?
Boy, you're going to be shocked if I'm a man in my next regeneration.
Yep. I think the best word or summit for this episode was said by Spike Milligan in The Goons.
It's all rather confusing, really.
I would agree.
I think the best thing about this episode is the music.
Yes.
Yeah.
The music is phenomenal.
More Chinese music, please. That was rather good. Mm. On the old Chinese violins.
I mean, but, What was that? What was what?
I'm not surprised it got 2.2 million viewers.
Oh, and loads of people are like, oh, yeah, you know, this is really good. You know, 2.2 million viewers, it doesn't matter. Yes, it does when the figures are this low.
Yes, it does. I'm sorry.
5 million views? No, I've got a bit of horse. I've got a soapbox I need to stand on a minute. 5 million views in this modern day and age is classed as good viewing. Okay, 15 years ago, 17 years ago, when Doctor Who restarted again, that was fairly poor. But do you know what? 5 million is a good thing now. 4 million is about average. 4.5 million, 3 million is bad. 2 million is really bad. I will be surprised if this makes 3 million in its 7-day run. We'll find that out tomorrow.
The thing is it's very telling, isn't it, that this was the 11th watched show on live TV, right, on that Easter Sunday. So that means there was 10 other shows, because I don't think there's this argument, well, people don't watch live TV anymore. People still do watch live TV. If it's worth watching, people will still tune in to live TV or live aired
it
TV.
It says summer when Britain's Got Talent, Coronation Street, EastEnders, The Thief, His Wife and a Canoe.
And the canoe, yep.
And Gardner's Question Time got more views.
Yeah. Gardner's Question Time beat Doctor Who. Are you absolutely effing serious?
Yeah.
Wow.
Springwatch. Sorry, not Gardner's Question Time.
Oh, still. I mean, I like a good garden like the next man, but wow. Yeah, it's just atrocious, really.
Now, I don't think we will ever have ratings as high as we used to have them. Doctor Who fans' opinions of going, oh, yeah, we miss the days of having 8 million views. That ain't going to happen anymore.
That ain't going to happen.
Because
no,
of the way that streaming works. We need more than 2 million.
I mean, if I think, to me, the consolidated numbers are the new overnight numbers. But still, like you said, I don't anticipate this getting over 3 million views. And if so, it'll be 3 million and some change, because this this did not wow anybody. This is not, again, one of the greatest things about, you know, getting into a show, especially day of and watching it, is like the cooler talk at work where people are just like, oh, did you see the latest? Oh, no, don't tell me about it because I'm going to watch it. I have it on, you know, I DVR'd it. I recorded it. I have it on the iPlayer. I'm going to watch it when we get home today. This would be like, oh, did you see the latest Doctor Who episode? No, don't bother. And then they don't.
I'm going to call it now. I reckon the consolidated for tomorrow is going to be 2.9 million, and that's being generous.
It's entirely possible.
Yeah. I'm going to go 3.2. Still not good, but I'm just going to go 3.2. No. That's my estimate.
I don't think after 30 days, I don't think it'll make it to 4 million.
Well, and we talked about it. Like, you know, I was anticipating the flux to get a lot of views, at least, you know, leading up to part six, since it was serialized. By episode six, it just fell off the face of the earth. The only bump that you had was the episode right after the Weeping Angels episode, because that was so good. People are like, oh, wait, maybe the next episode will be just as good as that one. And everybody found out that, no, it actually wasn't.
Mm.
Yeah. Question. This whole viewing figures, consolidated viewing, etc. stuff, do you have to have watched like the entire episode for it to count as a view, or
no?
Could you just like, or do people just hit play, could watch 10 seconds and then stop, and that's counted as, a view?
I think
what I understand in relation to Barb, which is different to Nielsen, which is what it is in America, it has to be 10 minutes or more.
Yeah, I believe that's what Netflix counts as a view for viewing figures, is beyond 10 minutes.
Okay.
Let's get to the conclusion of this episode. Don't you think it's just abysmal what Chibnall has done? And I don't mean to just trash him unilaterally or whatever. I want to look at this thing as a completionist. When we had The Flux, we were told it was a 6-part serialized story that will build upon each other, and then obviously with the 6th episode, we will have a conclusion. We never got a conclusion. So then we go to Eve of the Daleks, which actually does not continue on with a conclusion. Then we get into this episode, which I'm looking at some of a question answer that Chibnall did. They asked him if this is a standalone episode, and he said, yes, this is a standalone episode. So, like, you did not complete your storytelling. The Centaurans still are part of the Earth's history, where instead of the Russians, there it was the Centaurans. That's still a disaster. The world is still a disaster. The universe is still a disaster. And we've had Eve of the Daleks and we've had this one that have been both standalone stories. Your story was supposed to be so great and so comprehensive that it was going to take six parts. But yet, when we got to the end of six parts, nope.
He's just... They're diehard Chibnall fans, and they're a very vocal, very minor minority. And they are a minority. I don't care what they say about themselves. You know, it's telling. It's very telling that 2.2 million people watch this live.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and of course, don't forget, you know, people, people were more excited for the trailer. Well, if you can call it a trailer.
Oh, at the end? Yeah. That yeah. was... the best bit, and you know, I'm gonna be so not disappointed, not surprised if it's a crushing disappointment.
It's gonna be. What's to say it's not at this point? We've had three series of this.
Yeah.
He is going to ruin Ace. He's going to ruin Tegan.
He's gonna ruin Graham. He's gonna ruin Kate Stewart. He's gonna ruin any other characters he brings into it.
Because Chibnall is Chibnall.
Wait until he brings in the ultra PC cyber women army.
Oh, God.
So, Humphrey, you've been very quiet. What are your thoughts about all the clips that you've heard or what you were awake for this? What is your conclusion thoughts about this?
To be honest, it's a mess. There are just... It's not cohesive. You don't know where it's going half the time. Again... Some of the ideas in it are good, but it's poorly executed. Like, the idea of it being set in somewhere like China in the 19th century is actually really interesting, but it's just poorly, poorly done. And it's a shame because actually, like, I thought the voices for the Sea Devils were really good.
I agree.
I thought they were very like the classic series, slightly different, but then they were very different between the Sea Devils and Warriors of the Deep. So, that, you know, that's just how that works. And that's fine. You know, I thought they were done very well from that point of view. The music was very, very good, but the story itself was just shoddy, shoddy storytelling, lazy storytelling, and just completely confusing.
Liam, as somebody who watched a couple of YouTube channels and this, what are your thoughts?
Again, it's just been a bit of a mess, confusing, and it just, I just don't care. I noped out at Series 12. I've got no interest in Series 13. You know, I'll do these podcasts and stuff, but it's not enamoring me to go back and watch any of this era at all.
Do you ever foresee myself or Legeon having to do an apology to Chris Chibnall in the future?
Well, if it happens, then I can safely say after that series has ended, Doctor Who will be axed.
Yes, that's true enough.
Because at this point, I mean, it's clear. You know, the fact that it's... The creative control is not in the BBC's hands anymore is, again, telling, because they just, they're a ship in a fog and the lighthouse light is off and they're going towards the rocks at this point. If it wasn't for RTD or Bad Wolf, the show would be dead.
I very much agree with Liam. I think Doctor Who is on tenterhooks, and if RTD hadn't come along and went, said, give me creative control, it would be dead in the water, because I don't think anybody else wants to take it over. Mark Gatiss has said he doesn't want to.
Did he? When did he say that?
He did it in an interview last year. And they went, would you like to do it? And he went, no.
Oh, that That's how radioactive Doctor Who has become. Lifelong fans don't want to touch it. Here's an interesting statement. So here's a question from Chibnall's question and answer. It says, for anyone, so they asked him this question, for anyone who is coming to Doctor Who as a new viewer, is this an easy one to step into? Speaking of Legend of the Sea Devils, what do you hope families take from it? He said, replies, I think it's definitely a great episode to come into. It's got a lot of action, very heroic plots, lots of fun, big bad monsters, mad ideas, cinematic ambition, and all the stuff and great cast. We have a big epic rollicking fun adventure for you, whether you've never seen Doctor Who or you've seen every episode. And then for long-term audiences and fans of the show, there are loads of lovely little Easter eggs and nods to the past, so it's absolutely got something for everyone.
What nods?
If he's talking about the next time trailer, the next time trailer's not part of the episode.
The episode.
No, it isn't.
Because did the Sea Devils ever have swords even? I don't think they did.
No.
No, they had disc-shaped guns.
Yeah, I like the disc-shaped guns. I wish they would have had those, because I think, like I made mention in the previous podcast, Chibnall is the captain of the Poseidon. The Poseidon is upside down, and he sees nothing wrong with it. So what would you rate Legend of the Sea Devils?
I would probably give it a 4.5.
Legion?
I'd give it a 3.
Wow. I'd give it a 2. All right. So I guess with that, we will conclude the podcast. Stay tuned for the up-and-coming podcast where we do our April 2022 reviews. And are we doing our gift exchange at that time also? All right, so
reviews of
so
that.
So we have. I'm so excited! I am so excited! I cannot wait for the definitive breakdown of listening to you guys discuss Doctor Who Stranded 4. I'm very excited for that. The Doctor Who First Doctor Adventures, the Outlaws, the Doctor Who Unbound, Doctor of War 1 Genesis, Torchwood 1 Nightmares. I'm all about that. Torchwood Infidel Places, and then we have the Companion Chronicles Volume 3, which has not been released as of this time, but will by the time we get to the podcast. The Worlds of Blake 7 Heroes and Villains, and then Thunderbird. So I will tell you, because I'm listening to the Third Doctor or the Ninth Doctor Adventures, I will not be listening to the First Doctor Adventures because I don't know where I'm going to fit some of these things in. So, yeah.
Okay.
That's fair enough.
All right. I needed to, I think I need to tell everybody and just go through everything because I don't know if Humphrey knows what he's supposed to be listening to. So
I'm on the Magic Mousetrap.
Yep. You are on the Magic Mousetrap. I'm on the Ninth Doctor Adventures Volume 3. Of course you did. Yep. Of course, because you're an outstanding gentleman. Liam,
Humphrey. If you want to help, please leave a 5-star review on iTunes.
Legeon has Space 1999 Breakaway, and Liam has The Invisible Man, which was gifted to him by Humphrey. Yep. All right.
Cracking choice.
You have been listening to the Doctor Who Alhambra podcast. Doctor Who is owned and trademarked by the BBC. Doctor Who Alhambra is not affiliated with the BBC or Big Finish. No infringement is intended. Visit our website at alhambrapodcast.weebly.com or email the show at alhambraaudio@gmail.com. Tweet us at Alhambra Podcast. That is A-L-H-A-M-B-R-A podcast. Thank you.